This is Fight Fans Radio.
Welcome to Across the Pond. With your hosts, Andre Jacobs and Matt Simpson.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Fight Fans Radio, and welcome to Across the Pond MMA. Now, usually I start the show in the exact same way every single time, but I think it's only appropriate that I actually start the show by saying this sentence in the most dramatic, emotional, Daniel Day-Lewis, Denzel Washington way I possibly can. Let me bang, bro! Let me bang! Let me bang, bro! Hi, Matt. How you doing, man?
I'm doing pretty good. How about yourself?
That?
Yeah, that was fantastic.
Thank you. I actually studied drama from 11 to 18 years old.
Well, it really shone through with that performance right there.
Thank you. I was as funny as it sounds, 18-year-old Andre Jacobs was a Gleek or a Glee person. Or whatever, guys. Whatever you Americans call it. I was in the Fiat Club.
Well, we would call you something else all together entirely, but I won't do that.
Should we do that off air?
Yeah, we'll do that off air. But yeah, you need to let everyone know that maybe missed out on what you were referencing there, what that was from.
You know what? Just, guys, if you're in the MMA stratosphere, in the MMA world whatsoever, if you don't know what I was talking about, then first of all, give yourself a slap. Second of all, sort out your priorities. And third of all, watch the latest season of The Ultimate Fighter. Now, that's a hard and weird thing to say, considering it seems like no one is really watching this season of The Ultimate Fighter for, you know, various reasons. Partially because Roy Nelson and Shay Carwin is not the greatest partnership in the world, and the level of fighters in this season of Ultimate Fighter, not as great as it was in the beginning. But as you people who listen to the show on a regular basis know, this is about MMA 50% and, you know, pop culture / entertainment the other 50%, and this season of The Ultimate Fighter gave us the ultimate pop culture moment in MMA history. It's a man with a pink mohawk getting so angry and screaming. Shall I do it again? Shall I do it?
No. I don't. I think that's enough. I think we had one time was enough.
It's one of the greatest, in my personal opinion, the greatest moment of douchebaggery in The Ultimate Fighter's history. And there's been plenty of shenanigans that have ensued on that show. So, did I give it a worthy enough description?
I think you did. Those that are fans of, once again, as I always say, Jersey Shore, were probably very, very happy.
Oh, man, I was ecstatic. I was ecstatic, and I am a Jersey Shore fan. Regardless of that, and regardless of their shenanigans, Matt Simpson, what have you been up to, man? It's been a while. Well, it's not actually been a while. It's been 8 days.
It's been eight days, but we can say it's been a while. A little bit of this, a little bit of that. I've been getting in some Halo 4. I had my second session with my tattoo.
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah, you had your tattoo. We never spoke about it. How are you feeling?
The second session was, I wouldn't say, it really wasn't more painful, but the aftermath was, man, this son of a bitch is still a little sore. It burned for a good day.
Now, this is going to sound very weird, so I'm just wondering if this actually occurs in America as well. But what did you rub on your arm?
Aqua 4. It's like a vitamin D and vitamin E, like ointment.
You know what the best thing is to rub on a tattoo?
What's that?
Nappy cream. Bepanthen.
I don't even know what the hell that is.
Nappy rash cream.
Nappy rash cream?
Nappy rash cream is the best thing to rub on a tattoo.
I don't even. Where would I buy that at?
Any sort of supermarket. Whenever I've had my tattoos, I am not afraid to say, but I rub nappy rash cream upon my chest and my arm.
Well, right now I'm using Aquaphor and it's working out pretty good. So
that's tremendous, man.
But yeah, but no, it's coming along great. Altered Image, Monty has done a fantastic job. So I've got about three more sessions, and then it'll be done.
Have you found yourself wearing lower, like sleeveless wear just to show?
Oh yeah, I mean I'm every shirt that I have that has had the sleeves cut out of. That's pretty much all I'm wearing. So.
Do you do little movements or just sort of show off like, oh, look over there. Oh, look at my arm. It's full of ink.
It's pretty big, so I don't have to do much of anything. It's pretty hard to miss.
What's your mother say? What does Mama Simpson say?
She likes it. She likes it. Everybody likes it. I mean, I've waited so long to do this, and everybody knows how much it means to me. So everybody's been pretty cool about it. Nobody's given me any grief.
Outstanding, outstanding. I actually got kicked out of my house when I brought my tattoo home, so that was fun.
Nice. But
we're not here to talk about my issues and problems like that. We're here to talk about MMA. First one being Bellator 80.
It was Bellator 80. We're getting up there.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to be hitting Bellator 100 soon next year. Definitely next year, though.
Yeah, I'd say, yeah, definitely. I don't know what the schedule is going to be like on Spike, but I assume it'll keep the same pace as MTV too. So,
indeed. What do you think of this Bellator? I didn't get a chance to see.
It was really pretty average. Yeah, it was kind of. It was a lot of decisions. The only exciting fight, really, for me, was Volkov and Vincius. I mean, they had a pretty good scrap. Alexander Volkov, the heavyweight, looks fairly impressive standing. I mean, he's got nice combos, and obviously in this fight he showed he could land with a little bit of power when they add up. So he looked good in his fight. Rad Martinez got the win over Vagni Fabiano.
I heard that was a decent fight.
It was a decent fight. It was a back-and-forth fight. Rad, I think it really was a pretty close decision, at least from my standpoint. I mean, Rad Martinez got the win. I'm still not really impressed with him as far as taking the featherweight crown. Big thing, Joe Warren getting back in the cage after his devastating knockout, and he looked just like Joe Warren. smothered Owen. Complete total dominance for three rounds. And his attitude, you would think that his attitude might have gotten put in check, but he still considers himself now the greatest fighter at 135. So overall, it was a decent card. I mean, I guess I shouldn't say average card. I mean, because they have some there were some entertaining fights overall, but I'd say it was probably a B-. So overall, it's definitely, if you haven't checked it out, check out the highlights on YouTube. I mean, like they said, there's some exciting moments.
Tremendous. Now, I believe there's some big things going on with their welterweight tournament. They've got a War Machine on there, Douglas Lima, Paul Daly, and Ben Saunders, and fans get to actually vote on
who fights who.
So who are you picking if you're going to vote? Americans just loves a vote, don't they? Just love a fucking vote.
It would look that way with all the reality shows we have that are call-in votes and votes this and vote that. I really don't know. I mean, any of the matchups would be ones I'd like to see. I'm really going to be probably pulling though for Douglas Lima. I still really like that guy. I think that I don't want to say he is the best striker of the bunch. I mean, because you do have Paul Daly in that mix. But I really like...
Ben isn't a bad striker.
No, Ben Saunders. Yeah, but Ben, I have no faith in Ben. I mean, every time that guy gets to the top of the ladder, man, he falls. He slips. Mm. He misses a rung. And until he can prove otherwise, I have zero faith in that dude getting to the title. I mean, every time I've watched him... almost get there. Did it in the UFC. He's done it in Bellator now. He just slips up, and he is a guy that's well rounded and has he's
finally,
shown right off the back.
you remember there was a point in time where Ben Saunders was just a striker and, you know, he's got grappling skills now.
No, and a guy with the limbs on him like he does, he can be very dangerous on the ground because he can get submissions from positions that a lot of other people can't. But I just don't have any faith in him. I don't trust him. I think he gets in there with Daly or Lima, and he gets hurt and put out. So I'm going.
No love for War Machine.
No love for War Machine, dude. And what? I mean, that's a Bellator seems like their thing now. I know they just signed some other career criminal.
Yeah. I heard about that, but I'm not sure who the person is. I just heard genuine sadness.
Yeah, I don't get that. I don't know why Bjorn. I mean, maybe he likes hard luck cases, and so
look, he's just trying to give some brothers a chance. You know what I'm saying?
I guess that's it. But but regardless, I'm loving me some Douglas Lima in this tournament.
Tremendous, tremendous, tremendous. What else was on the show? Oh yeah, of course, UFC Macau. I'm assuming there were actually people who watched that show. What time is it in the morning for you guys?
It started at 8, which I mean, dude, I swear it doesn't matter if I remind myself the entire week that okay, this event is taking place on the other side of the world, so I need to get up to watch the fight. The night before, my brain shuts off, and that morning, I mean, I completely forget that the fights are happening. So I was messing around on my phone and saw some people tweeting about Alex Caceres, his victory, and I was like, what the hell is he fighting right now? Oh, man, I'm so so I missed the Facebook prelims, but luckily my DVR saved me from missing the rest of the card.
Okay, cool. What did you think of the card? It wasn't bad.
I really enjoyed it. And by far and away, though, for me, I mean, the main event was fantastic. But what I enjoyed the most was seeing a Takanori Gomi that looked like Takanori Gomi. So yeah. We talked about it last show. I mean, I thought that Mac Danzig would just go in there with his strength and his technical striking
Honestly, when I first watched it, I had Mac Danzig winning, actually. And then the next time I watched it, I had Gomi winning. It was a close, close fight.
No, it was a very close fight. I thought, honestly, that the way the decision with, who was it? I think it was John Tuck and Tiaquan Zhang went, I kind of thought that Mac Danzig was going to get the decision. But I had Gomi winning it, so I think he was deserving of the win. I mean, I was really impressed with him. Not that Takanori Gomi is going to be lighting up the lightweights by any stretch of the means, but I was just very, very, very happy to see him get a win and remain in the lightweight division. And even with Mac Danzig, even though he's been back and forth and stuff, another fight of the night. The guy continues to give us exciting fights. I don't think he's going anywhere either. But that was by far and away I enjoyed that fight the most of all of the fights that were on the card. Even though we did have another surprise, I guess, with the main event.
Surprise! I'm pretty sure everyone. I'm pretty sure everyone genuinely thought there was no. I saw no one believe that Hung Lee was going to win.
I don't know that Kung Lee thought he was going to win. I mean, going into the fight, he was saying he's 80%, still recovering from the bone bruise that he couldn't kick in practice. And so the only reason he stayed in this fight was because of its location, being in China. So, I mean, that's why I think how excited. I mean, yes, it was in China, but I mean, I honestly think that the guy going into that fight, he was really down on himself. And then Rich Franklin made the which I really can't believe a guy that is intelligent and has the fighter IQ that he has would make the mistake of throwing a leg kick without covering or throwing combos with it. I mean, that is such, to me, I mean, it's one of the biggest mistakes you see the most often inside the cage is guys throwing leg kicks and not covering after the kick. If you just throw the single leg kick, if you don't do that, you got to set it up. You got to protect yourself. And Franklin just left it out there and then got tagged.
How shocked were you?
Oh, I was blown away. I mean, my daughter was actually taking a nap in my wife was watching the fight with me, and throughout the card, I was pretty reserved. And when that happened, I mean, I was like, holy shit! And I was like, what? No. Wake up our daughter. But I was just ecstatic. And I rewound it and watched it like 5 times. It's like, I cannot believe that he just did that. And you got to feel really good for Kung Lee. I mean, just looking at his reaction and stuff afterwards, I mean, you got to feel horrible for Rich, though, because I mean, Kung Lee, I don't think, especially after interviews, he doesn't seem like has any interest in a title run. Whereas Rich was really hoping to get one last title run going, and obviously that's not going to be in the cards for him.
No, do you reckon Rich might retire after that? Because I'm not going to lie, I don't even think Anderson Silva knocked him out that badly.
No, it was absolutely devastating. I mean, my wife was going, "Is he dead?" I was like, I don't know, maybe. No, he's not dead, but he's definitely lost some of his childhood memories.
Wow.
He was definitely one of the most devastating knockouts I've seen in a long time. And I would say that, yeah, I think that, I mean, Rich has done enough in the sport, and I think it is probably time to take a step back, especially after suffering something like that.
I believe that he's a Hall of Famer.
I would agree with that. I wouldn't argue that point. I mean, I think
if you're going to have Matt Hughes in there, then, you know, he's part of that generation of fighters that him and Matt Hughes, you know, some of the guys that helped bring in Chuck and Tito and those guys. So they should get he should get a Hall of Fame nod in my eyes, but he should also retire now. That's the point, man. You got nothing to prove.
No, that's right. I mean, to me, it's always about eventually attaining the gold, and once you've made the money and whatnot. And Rich has made the money, and he's clearly not going to make a run for the gold. So why take any more of a beating? Let's just get out of the sport, and you can, you know, go to coaching it or doing something else. And just I mean, he's a guy that actually I wouldn't mind listening to commentate him, because he does know a ton about MMA, and he's a very intelligent individual.
Yeah, very well spoken. For sure. What other card? What did you think of Thiago Silva versus Stanislav Nedkov?
It was beautiful, man. I'm glad. I was so. I like Thiago Silva, and so getting to see Thiago do the neck, the slit in the throat, and all the stuff that he does. I was so happy to see that guy get a win too. This was like the card of me being happy, because I was really happy to see Kung Lee win. I like Rich Franklin, but seeing Kung Lee with the problems he had going into the fight, get the win there in China. I'd love to see that. Silva coming back after Nedkov crowned him. I mean, that was a great fight. I was glad to see Thiago come back and get the win through the adversity. I mean, he got rocked too. I mean, he was hurt bad.
Yeah, no, for sure. Go on.
It's almost that after coming back from that in that third round, he just took Stanislav's heart, man, just ripped it right out, and it was like Nedkov just shut down. So props to Silva.
I wonder what the odds were of Thiago Silva winning via submission. I wonder what kind of odds there were in the third round as well. How much money could you have made?
I don't know. I wouldn't think they would have been that ridiculous. I mean, Thiago's got a submission game, and you got to figure that he gets a TKO. I don't know. I wouldn't really think they'd be that crazy. I mean,
I think the odds must have been pretty good.
Yeah, they might have been. I mean, I guess I could see 5-6-1. I mean, he does have some submissions though. So give the guy a break. Are we knocking on Thiago saying that he has no submission? He's a black belt in BJJ.
Yeah, but there are a lot of black belts in BJJ who are like, being a black belt in BJJ these days just seems
right. But Tiago's got good top control.
Rashad Evans is a black belt in BJJ.
Right, but Tiago's got good top control. I think that, I don't know. I'd say yeah, you probably are right. They were probably pretty crazy odds. He was probably getting 6-1, 7-1, something along those lines.
I knew you'd see my way of thinking things sooner or later.
I still don't totally agree with that though. I mean, in MMA, it can go either way. So, I mean, all it takes is somebody getting rocked, and the next thing they're getting a rear naked choke.
Yeah, that's true. Any news happened this week? Oh, apparently this is going to be the last Strike Force card. What were your thoughts? Were you surprised? If you were.
Man, I am so upset this is the last Strike Force card.
That's so sarcastic.
I kind of am upset because, I mean, that I look forward. That's like my favorite Twitter moment is getting on Twitter during the Strikeforce cards and making fun of the commentary team. I think that's probably as a good example as to why it's going to be defunct is that when you really enjoy making fun of the commentary versus watching the fights. So hopefully somebody picks up Frank Shamrock because I really don't know that I could go the rest of my life without hearing Frank read from the teleprompter in a very monotone voice. So I hope that somebody takes Frank Shamrock and puts him in their promotion.
I don't need to hear anymore. I'm not gonna lie to you. I don't need to hear anymore. It's the worst. I usually listen to the commentary because I like to see if I think I've got something, you know, a completely different idea, to what Joe Rogan or Jimmy Smits or Mike Goldberg are saying, but I don't want to hear it again. I'm sorry.
Well, I think that you're in the minority. I think everybody wants a little bit of Frank Shamrock, but it sucks for the Strikeforce. I mean, it does suck to see a promotion go down because that means that there's a lot of lower tier guys that won't be getting picked up by the UFC and might not even get picked up by a Bellator, so they're going to be back in the local circuit trying to work their way up.
Okay, cool, man, cool. Well, yeah, no, I agree. What else happened?
I think there was some announcement about women's MMA, maybe, was there? Something along those lines?
Oh, yeah, on the Rousey. Did that actually happen, though?
Did it actually happen?
Did it actually happen, or is something, you know, is
I mean, it seems like it's, I mean, there's, everything points to yes. I mean, if you shake the magic eight ball, so I think all signs point to yes, that it is actually happening. I don't know that I read anywhere where was there an official announcement? I mean, you're the MMA journalist.
I am the MMA journalist, but it's also a Sunday. I believe I read something that said that her manager has denied the TMZ report, but I've also not seen anything on any of the major websites, on any of the major MMA websites. So,
well, and Dana tweeted out a smiley face just after TMZ announced it. So,
see, that annoys me.
Is that a coincidence?
Minus the fact, is it a coincidence or not? When has a dude tweeting out a smiley face become real news? Only in the weird world of journalism. Oh, sorry, mixed martial arts.
As I say, yeah, throw in MMA there.
Has a smiley face been literally headline news on websites? I don't understand. It's hilarious. It'd be great to try and explain it to someone who doesn't really understand MMA. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
But, yeah, is she coming? Is she not coming? I don't know. I really hope she does. That sounded wrong. Is she going
as
to
be say, it did sound strange. That's one of those sound bites that we're going to have to just, you know, rip out and then put in the highlight reel.
Erica needs to rip that sound bite out, and then literally whenever one of us says something stupid, that's what happens. Is she coming? I don't know if she's coming. I hope she's coming. But I don't know if she's gonna go to the UFC. I'm not sure, honestly. I'd like to see it happen though, because there are some women who I think could definitely deserve to be in the UFC. But whether or not that happens, who knows?
Well, but I think it's just a matter of her popularity is just skyrocketing, especially in the last 3 to 4 months. It seems like everybody she's not even fighting, and her popularity continues to grow.
Okay, here's my question to you, because I think it's obviously the sport is much bigger in America. Is she like Gina Carano level? Like if a normal person sees her, she'd be like, oh shit, that's Ronda Rousey.
No, she's not Gina Carano level, but she's definitely, like I said, I think her popularity, I think the UFC has to take notice that WMMA's, it's the sport's popularity is growing leaps and bounds, and Ronda Rousey's on top of it.
Yeah, maybe. Who knows? Right. I don't think there was anything else, to be honest. But we do have a little event called UFC 154 happening next week.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think there's a championship fight happening, maybe.
Yeah, there's a little return of some...
Some guy's returning. I don't think he's any good, though.
Bald Canadian dude, right?
Yeah.
French Canadian dude.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure he sucks, so nobody's probably going to watch it.
Yes, it's the return of GSP, and before all of you people go crazy and go, look at that company, Matt said he sucks. He was being sarcastic.
I was not being sarcastic. GSP is garbage. He's barely, what is he, top two, maybe?
Top two, potentially, possibly, who knows, it's arguable. yes, GSP is back, and it's going to be interesting. However, we'll get to that at the top of the card, because there are many things that we need to talk about regarding the card in general. So let's get down to some predictions. Where do you want to start, Matt? Do you want to start from the bottom, or do you want
Let's start from the bottom. It's a huge card.
It's a huge card. Erica.
Hi.
Hi. Do you like how I summoned you?
I do.
Cool. That sounded ridiculously slighty from both of us. Can we do it like last week, where you give us the people, and then we'll talk, and then on the odd occasion that we'll give you ask your opinion, not that it really matters. But yes.
Oh wow, rude.
Can I just do that?
Zing.
You're talking for 154, right?
Yes. Preliminary card forward, upward.
Preliminary card. So you want the FX preliminary card?
Facebook. Guessing. Facebook preliminary card. Let's start at the very bottom.
Oh wow, we're gonna do everything. All right. So starting
bottom.
So the Facebook prelims start at 6 p.m. Eastern time, and it starts off with John McGuire versus Matt Riddle.
Oh my God, that fight's actually happening. Is that the first fight on the card?
That is the first fight on the Facebook card, yes indeed.
Oh,
glad we're talking about, I'm glad we're talking about this card now that Andre realized what fights are actually going to be on it.
I've been very busy this week with work, so I completely forgot that John McGuire was actually fighting against Matt Riddle. Quick question, has anyone seen what Kevin Randleman had to say about Matt Riddle?
No, I did not. What happened?
I would advise you, I'm not really sure what's happened. Erica, have you seen this?
I have indeed heard about Kevin Randleman really laying it into Matthew Riddle, but I'm not sure why.
Yeah, he went deep. He went deep, man. But I would just advise you guys to try and find it online. It's a very interesting, albeit weird, watch, definitely. But let's go into predictions. John McGuire versus Matt Riddle. Mr. Simpson, who you got?
I'm going with Matthew Riddle in this fight, man. John McGuire did not look. I guess he looked very John McGuire less than in his last out. Given that was against John Hathaway, and Hathaway's a fantastic fighter in his own right. But Matthew Riddle, on the other hand, I think he looked pretty good his last out. He looked like he was getting back to his wrestling. He's got good submission defense. I think that John McGuire is going to have his hands full in this fight.
I'm going to go against you in this one, and I'm going to go with John McGuire, not because he's a Brit. I'm actually going to go with him because as strong as Matt Riddle is, as much of a bully in the cage as he can be, there's something about Matt Riddle that says I don't think he has any fight smarts.
No, I agree with
actually,
that.
That's a complete lie. Every time I watch Matt Riddle, besides from his last fight, there were some points in the last fight where it showed that he just didn't have fight smarts. Like, yeah, he got the arm triangle choke, but it's really against the guy who doesn't really have any grappling. John McGuire does. And when it comes to striking, all I can ever think of when it comes to Matt Riddle is I believe he fought Sean Pearson, and he threw an extraordinary number of strikes, kicks, hooks, jabs, power strikes, everything. And he hit air the entire time. Does anyone remember this fight?
Yeah, I know. Matt Riddle, he doesn't perform well every time he comes out. But he's very durable. And like I said, John McGuire just, maybe John's having issues, but I don't think he's going to be able to. I think if Matt Riddle comes out the way he likes to, which is just balls to the wall, I think John McGuire's going to have trouble with even with his gypsy jiu-jitsu or whatever the hell he calls it.
What I'm going to say is I can think you're completely right. He is going to come out balls to the wall, but coming out balls to the wall will... how many times am I going to have to say balls to the wall today? It's crazy, isn't it?
Have you been saying it a lot today before the show? I mean, just randomly?
In general, I'm just genuinely thinking of balls to general walls.
You have lots of problems today.
problem, child. But I just think with what you said, you know, how he apparently has, he's going to go balls to the wall. I think that's going to lead to mistakes. And Maguire's going to take advantage of said mistakes and deal with him and get the win by submission.
I agree with Andre.
Fuck what you say, homie.
Yeah, I don't think Matt Riddle could have beat the John Maguire that lost to
John Hathaway.
Well, we will find that. Here, if you want to put it in a real technical term, right? I see Matt Riddle making scrambles. A lot of scrambles in that fight. He's going to try to take down John May, stop it, and there you have openings. And it's going to be one of those openings where John goes, right, that's mine, and he takes it and he gets the win. I genuinely think that. Anyone who, in my opinion, wants to try and beat John McGuire, you have to stop the scramble from happening. High-risk situations like that, McGuire feeds off, and he's probably he's on that vein of Carlos Condit in the sense of if you see an opportunity, you snatch it up, and that's what Maguire does, and he does it very well. And I think that Matt Riddle will make an opportunity for John to actually take something. Cool. I was clearly silencing Matt and changed his mind. So, Erica,
not at all. Go ahead.
Shut the fuck up.
Next fight is going to be Darren Elkins versus Steven Seiler.
Oh, wow. This is a really stacked card. I'm going to go for... Actually, no, Matt, what do you think? Because I have a feeling I know what you're going to say.
I really went back and forth on this because it's really a matter of can Darren Elkins get Steven Seiler to the ground and then control him. I think Seiler's stand-up is going to be far better than Elkins. Like I said, I was going back and forth, and I ended up going with Seiler. I'm probably going to regret it but come fight night, but I'm going with Steven Seiler, split decision victory in the featherweight bout.
Okay. Do you know what? I'm going to go with Darren Elkins trying to... it's really hard. We're just full of sexual innuendos today.
Nice.
What I meant to say was that I just think that Steven Seiler is very much in the vein of John McGuire in the sense that he does well in the scramble, but I think that he's a worse wrestler than John McGuire, and Darren Elkins will take opportunity to take... take the opportunity and take him down and hold him there for three rounds and get the unanimous 29-28 decision. I think he'll gas in the third, and Steven Seiler will go for try and finish the fight as much as he can, but he won't be able to.
Yeah, the fight could definitely go that direction. And Elkins has got his last three wins are against solid opponents. You know, he took the hype away from Diego Brandão, so I think it's going to be an interesting fight.
No, for sure. Next one, please, Erica.
Next one, please, darling.
Oh, that was kind of scary. Azamat Gashmov versus Ivan Minjavar. I don't even know who Azamat is.
Sorry, could you say that one again, please?
I think it's Azamat Gashmov.
Wait. Say again. One more time?
I'm not doing it again. That's it.
Let's just call him G. Matt.
Well, from what I've seen of Gashmov, he's basically a crappy version of Ivan Menjivar. I shouldn't say crappy version, but he's an all around fighter. He's decent off his back. He's got decent scrambling ability. He's got a double leg. He can stand and bang. But Ivan Menjivar is a different level of competition for this kid. So I see Menjivar winning this any way he wants. I think he could get the submission. He could get the TKO. He definitely could easily get a decision win here. But as of right now, I'm going with going to go with the UD. I think he'll end up getting a decision. Russians are notoriously hard to finish.
That just sounded so weird. Russians so hard to finish, man. Ugh.
They are, man. They're tough. They're a tough breed.
I'm gonna go with Menjivar as well. I've not really seen much of what's his name again? Gazayev?
Gazimov.
Gazimov.
Azma is right. That's the only thing I know that is correct from watching his fights, listening to his name pronounced.
So Azimov, whatever his name is. I'm just gonna go with Ivan Menjivar. I trust that he wants to get put on a good show because that's the type of fighter he is, and he also needs to make some money, so I feel like he'll try and make this into maybe a fight of the night performance. I think his striking's probably better. On the ground, I think he's much better. I don't see much in his opponent, to be honest. See how I managed to get away with not actually saying his name. But thank you. Thank you very much. Next, please, Erica.
Yes, sir. Antonio Carvalho versus Rodrigo Damn.
Rodrigo Damn! Matt, who you got?
Carvalho all the way here. Rodrigo Damn, solid on the ground. Stand-ups, suspect. He's got a suspect chin. I got Antonio Carvalho catching him. TKO victory. I mean, Carvalho brings he's a judoka, karate, BJJ guy. I think that he's the better fighter here, and we'll get the win pretty handily here.
No, I completely agree. I actually have nothing to add to that. You said it. You pretty much took all the words from my mouth. Didn't we have a conversation about this where, you know, you leave some of the things to me, Matt?
There's not a whole lot. That fight's pretty easy to pick, so that was an easy one.
It's pretty easy to pick.
Which that probably means that Dam's going to get some kind of flying triangle or something.
Wouldn't that just be amazing? It's not going to happen, but next one, please, Erica.
The next fight on the card is at the beginning of the effects preliminary card, starting at 8 p.m. Eastern time, and starting off with Mark Bocek versus Rafael Dos Anjos.
Before we actually talk about this fight, I'm slightly offended by something that Erica just said. This show is called Across the Pond MMA, and you can't even give the English times either. Has to be about American. What the hell, dude? Like, for real?
I mean, the world runs on Eastern Standard Time, so I don't know.
Who do you mean the world runs on Eastern Standard Time?
I'm saying everything.
Where's the GMT?
I don't know. What time is it there right now for you?
It's the time right now is.
He doesn't even know.
It's 6:38.
Okay. All right, so the preliminary card starts on, I'm assuming, is it FX there as well, or is it a different station?
It's UFC.tv.
The preliminary card starts on FX and UFC.tv, 8 p.m. Eastern time, and is that 1 a.m.?
Yeah, it is 1 a.m.
1 a.m.? GMT, that's
See, it doesn't even matter, Andre, because nobody's going to be up watching it except for like you and maybe one other guy that's had too much to drink already.
That's offensive. Of course, though, we have people watching the UFC. That's a lot. That's why you see that. I see most English people on Twitter at like 1 a.m. in the morning. That's genuinely what I see because I've got mostly UFC people on my Twitter. So, yes, the majority of us will be up watching the show at 1 a.m. in the morning. That's why yesterday's show was so fantastic. I was in bed in four in the afternoon watching the fights. It was beautiful. Who you got for that one, Matt?
Well, I like Bocek in this fight, but I actually like Rafael Dos Anjos more. I think that his stand-up has just consistently showed improvement. Bocek likes to bully his opponent, get him to the ground. and just control him on the ground, and he won't be able to do that, in my opinion, with Rafael Dos Anjos. Dos Anjos is a slick ground fighter, and I think his stand-up's going to be the difference in this fight. I think he'll eventually catch Bocek. I really went back and forth on this, but I think he's going to hurt him, get him to the ground, and get the submission due to the fact that Bocek is hurt. I mean, if they were just scrambling on the ground, he's not going to catch Mark Bocek. He's going to have to hurt him first. I think he'll do that and victory via knockdown submission.
Cool. I'm going to go with Rafael Anjos with this one as well. As you said, I think his, you know, striking is much better than Bocek, who really has no striking, if anything. And his jiu-jitsu is good enough for him to try and defend things if it goes to the ground, and that's it, it goes to the ground. So I'm going to go with Rafael Dos Anjos. Yes. Next one, please, Erica.
The next fight on the card is John McDessie versus Sam Stout.
Oh, a stand-up special, really, isn't it? This was. You know why John Joe Silver made this fight. Matt, who you got, man?
I tell you what, I really, really like John McDessie, and but I also enjoy Sam Stout's fights. I think though that Sam Stout has started to slow a little bit. I thought that. I even thought that he really lost that fight to Spencer Fisher. It was a really close fight, but I felt like he lost. He has that loss to Thiago Tavares. I'm actually going to go with McDessie in this fight. I think that even though McDessie, I think he's coming off back-to-back losses, if I'm not mistaken. They're both fighting in Canada. Obviously, I think that's going to get them both going. I think that McDessie, though, will come out on top. I mean, he's just such a powerful striker. And has a larger, he's more of a dynamic striker than Stout is. So as long as Stout doesn't try to take the fight to the ground and control McDessie, I think that McDessie wins this fight.
I'm going to disagree with you and go with Sam Stout. I think he's not as powerful as John McDessie, but I think he's more technical, and I think he'll be able to punish him on the feet if he gets the chance. If it goes to the ground, because, you know, Sam Stout is a glorified wrestler after the Spencer Fisher fight, NCAA style, I think he'll be able to, or I definitely know he'll be able to.
Oh, if he goes to the ground, he'll be able to control it. And I think that's where he's going to have to take the fight. If he wants to go for a fight of the night, though, and keep it standing, I think he's going to get caught and get hurt by McDessie.
Okay. Erica, what's the next one, please, darling?
Next on the card will be Cyril Diabate versus Chad Griggs.
I don't care card.
You mean the I don't care fight, not the card?
No, I have my I'm using my I don't care card.
Your actual card that says I don't care. I don't blame you here. I really didn't want to pick this fight either, but yeah, I think I might use the I don't care card, but I'm gonna go ahead and throw out a Chad Griggs upset special in this, but I don't really feel like breaking it down, so I'm going to use my I don't care card as well.
I wouldn't even give you guys like my genuine thoughts on who I think is going to win, but yeah, next one please, Erica, unless you have, you know, thoughts on who's going to win.
I don't care card.
Oh wow, okay, yeah. Cool, everyone's used their I don't care card.
Headlining the preliminary card will be Patrick Cote versus Alessio Sakara.
Patrick Cote knocks him out. Next, please. Oh, sorry, Matt, you want
to... I'm right there with you. Cote's granite chin. Sakara, not so much. Patrick Cote gets the win and gets to fight again in the UFC.
Indeed. On to the main card? Is it onto the main card now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is.
Main card, starting off the main card, will be Mark Hamnick versus Pablo Garza.
Oh, Matt.
I mean, Mark Hamnick, I think, has his fight all over the place. I mean, Pablo Garza, he's got a couple highlight reel finishes. But outside of that, I have no belief in this guy being able to beat Mark Hamnick. Even though, and on top of that, Hamnick's on a three-fight loss streak. I mean, he needs the win. Could you imagine though, if he loses, you think the UFC would get rid of him? Do you think they'd cut him? I don't. It'd be four in a row.
I think they cut him.
You think they do? So that being said, Hominick's got to win here. And I think he's the more talented fighter. I mean, his stand-up is – he's got the great technical stand-up on the ground. He'll avoid Garza's submissions. I think he gets the win here. I'm going to go TKO. I think he's going to get the TKO victory.
Cool. I'm also going to go with Hominick. You know, his back's against the wall. We're going to have to see how much willpower he has and how much personality he has to try and get through this entire thing. And I think he's got it. I think he's more of a technical fighter than Pablo Garza. Pablo Garza obviously has the long limbs and whatnot, so Hominick will have to watch out for the submissions. But as long as he's able to do that, he should be able to win. Otherwise, if Pablo Garza wins, it ain't going to be by decision. It's going to be a blazing knockout, flying knee.
Yeah, I agree with that. He's going to have to be fantastic for Garza to win. Another highlight finish.
Yep, definitely. Did you just hear any music come through? Oh.
No, I did not.
Okay, there was an advert.
Are the little people talking to you again?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay.
Next on the card?
Yes, let's move on.
Talk about Batman.
Konstantinos Filippou versus Nick Ring.
Konstantinos Filippou smashes, in my opinion. Absolutely crushes him.
You think I don't know that he'll crush him. I mean, Nick Ring is
Ring is the king of getting decisions that he doesn't deserve.
No, he is the king of that, but I don't know that. But like I said, I don't know that Filippou. I agree that Filippou gets this win. I think it'll be a UD. He probably will dominate the fight, but I don't know. I mean, when you say crush, I don't think he crushes him.
I think he crushes him.
That was some really good. I mean, we really, really did a great job of analyzing that fight.
Yeah, well, would you like to can you enlighten us, please?
No, I mean, I think that you say he's going to crush him. I say not so much. We both think he's going to win. I think that's good enough.
Fair enough. no, honestly, you've made me feel bad now, so I've got to go in there. I just think that even though Nick Ring is a big middleweight, I'm also going to say that Konstantinos Filippou is the stronger man. And to be able to out-muscle him and get him to the floor and probably deliver some damage there. So that's my reasoning.
I think that's good enough. So let's move on to the next fight on the card.
Oh, you just didn't want to talk about the fight. Okay, I understand. I get it now. I see what you were going there. I get it. All right, cool. Next fight, please, Erica.
Give me 1 second. And
hey, great radio!
Sorry. Next fight on the card will be Tom Lawler versus Francis Carmont, or as I like to call him, the French Cookie Monster.
What the fuck?
What?
He sounds like a French Cookie Monster, no lie. Like that deep, guttural, kind of like unintelligible speak, but it's got a French accent to it.
Do you care to do an example for us?
No.
Oh, I can do a Cookie Monster.
No, we don't need you to do a Cookie Monster, Andre.
Cookie Monster.
Yeah, so
that
he
sounds
like
a rapist. That didn't sound like a Cookie Monster.
So he sounds like that, but with
a
French accent.
How do you know what a rapist sounds like? You freak.
I mean, it's just what I envision it sounding like, you know.
Whoa. Too far.
Man. Heavy breather. Cookie Monster. Settle down. Yeah. Okay, back to the fight. Tom Lawler, really shouldn't win this fight, but I'm going to say that he does via KO. I think Francis Carmont is by far and away the better fighter here. I think that he's in close-up striking. He's got great uppercuts, knees, hooks, on the ground. He can get he's got a nice double leg. I think he can control Tom from the top. But for some reason, I just think that Tom's going to come out to something really, really stupid, and it's going to make Francis confused, along with everybody watching the show, and it's going to allow Tom to get the victory.
Okay, fair enough. I'm going to go Francis Carmont, simply because the dude is an animal. I don't know how he makes it to 185 pounds, but you know, Tom Lawler isn't a small dude either. But I think he's going to make Tom Lawler look like a really, really small middleweight. And yeah, I'm going to have to go Carmont, just overpowering him, probably getting a rear naked choke, a really bad one at that, but he's just so powerful he's able to stop it.
That's really what should happen, is that Francis Carmont should come out and dominate Tom Lawler. But for some reason, it's just one of those, again, counter move decisions that will win me money. I think Tom Lawler is going to catch him.
How are you doing on counter move these days, anyway?
I'm actually doing really well. I've been making money. Evidently well enough that counter move constantly tweets me out on Friday. So.
Really?
Yes.
Nice. Very nice. Next fight, please.
Next fight is Johnny Hendricks versus Martin Kampman.
Wow, we'll be there already? God, we're in a co-main event. God damn. This is why I like having you here, Erica, because I can genuinely relax whilst you tell me who's fighting instead of me having to look, so that's fantastic. Matt, who you got?
Oh, boy. This was a tough one for me. And it has a lot to do with the fact that I really, really like Johnny Hendricks. But Martin Kampman, man, that guy is just fantastic. I think he's probably one of the most underrated welterweights that are among the top ones in the division. Fantastic stand-up. Solid takedown defense, but if it goes to the ground, the guy can scramble. He's got a nasty guillotine. I really can't see how Johnny Hendricks wins this fight outside of landing one of his big shots, countering Martin. I mean, I think, if Johnny could get the fight to the ground and try to control Martin, but I think Martin gets it back up and standing. Johnny Hendricks, even though his stand-up is much, much improved, stands no chance against Martin Kampman in a stand-up fight. So I'm going to go with Martin Kampman, UD. I don't think he finishes Johnny Hendricks, but I think that he beats down Johnny Hendricks pretty good.
I'm going to go with Johnny Hendricks, Randy Couture, and him using the Greco-Roman against the cage, potentially taking him down, but really beating him up from the inside. I think Martin Kampman is an opportunistic fighter, literally the most opportunistic fighter in the world when it comes to it. He gets battered and then somehow he manages to just make the right decision at the right time, just in time. I don't think he'll be able to get to do that against Johnny Hendricks. I think Johnny Hendricks is too good. And I think he's going to have to use, but I do think he's going to have to use his wrestling, his Greco-Roman, and really hold on to him and keep him where he is.
Yeah, I don't see that happening, man. I hope you're right, because I really would like to see Johnny Hendricks win this fight and just continue to improve. But Martin, I mean, I think he beat Diego Sanchez, and he's just really on a roll. And
everyone thinks he beat Diego Sanchez. It's not something that anyone argues with. He definitely.
No, and to go a little further back, I think he beat Jake Shields. So I mean, the guy should be on like a 7-fight win streak. So. Yeah. I think that, I mean, he's fought some great wrestlers and guys that are good at getting takedowns and stuff and come out on top. So I just can't see where Johnny wins this fight. But I hope you're right. I hope I'm wrong.
Okay, cool. And on to the main event. Who you got, Matt? George St. Pierre versus Carlos Condit. I'd usually let Erica drop it down, but I really wanted to say it myself, because I'm a douchebag like that.
Man, have you been watching the primetime?
I saw the first one. I haven't seen the second one. I'm saving that for later on tonight if I can stop watching Dragon Ball Z.
Okay, we won't go any further there. But yeah, I tell you what, man, I am so excited to see GSP back inside the cage because of some of the things he's been saying on primetime. It sounds like the guy that we might see the old GSP, the one before Matt Serra knocked out the will to really go for the kill.
What? You may regret those words, sir.
I may regret those words, and the fact that Winkle John is coaching Carlos Condit. I mean, we might just see these guys throw jabs for 5 rounds, but I hope not.
You're going to see Carlos Condit throw jabs for 5 rounds. You're going to see him throw combination after combination of awkwardness but effective striking.
So do you think Carlos Condit is definitively the better striker here?
I think he's the more dangerous striker.
Okay, well. So, comparing the striking. Who's got the most KO power? I'm just, who is the better striker?
I think George St. Pierre's a more technical striker than him. But then again, I think that Carlos Condit takes the more chances and gains the most rewards from his striking. So I'm gonna go. For me personally, I prefer watching Carlos Condit strike than watching George St. Pierre strike.
I would 100% agree with that. I just wanted to see where you were. But going back and forth on this fight, it really, to me, it is who decides to come in and just try to take the fight over. I think if either of them were to decide to fight a fight from the outside and try to just win the decision, that would be the downfall. Because I really think one of these guys is going to come in and just completely take over the fight. And I'm thinking it's going to be George St. Pierre. I think that we're going to see old George. I think that all the stuff he's saying, I mean, fighters always try to say the right things going into a fight. So, I mean, I could just be buying into the stuff coming out of George's mouth, and it could be just all BS. And when he gets in there, he's going to just try to get a decision win. And Carlos, you know, being the natural born killer that he is, if that happens, I think Carlos might actually even finish GSP. But if we see old GSP, Carlos Condit is in for a world of shit. Rory McDonald was able to do some serious damage to Carlos Condit. And is Carlos Condit a better fighter than when he fought Rory McDonald? Absolutely. But Rory McDonald, as great as he has become, is not GSP. And I think that GSP wins this fight handily.
You see, I see where you're coming from. And usually I'd agree with you. But I'm actually going to go with Carlos Condit for this fight. You know, call me crazy or whatever. And everyone sort of...
I don't think you're crazy, though. I mean, I think Carlos Condit has definitely got a shot. I just think that GSP... Do you think he could... But if this is a GSP that is just, I'm going in there to crush Carlos Condit, you still think Carlos Condit wins? Or are you leaning this towards the ACL injury? I mean, is that playing into it, along with the fact that GSP's fought a lot of safe fights recently?
I think Carlos Condit is probably one of the most lethal guys that GSP can fight, because you know he's going to go... He doesn't give a damn. He's going to go for that leg. He's not going to feel any sort of remorse. He's going to go for it, and he's going to try and finish him from there. And I think that's going to play mind tricks with GSP. You've heard him talk about how he's scared, how when he goes to the octagon, he's scared. And we've seen how he acted when he got poked in the eye, and how he reacted with the whole Matt Serra thing. And, you know, Carlos Condit, he doesn't talk much, but he can get into your head by fighting. Just frustration that you can imagine, the leg kick slapping off the knee, just being awkward and dangerous. I think it might frustrate GSP, and I think there might be an opportunity for St. Pierre to actually get the finish and win. No, I'm sorry, and Carlos Condit to get the finish and win.
And Condit's not a guy that breaks. So GSP, even if early in the fight he's getting the double legs and putting Condit on his back and doing damage, it's not going to make Condit any different of a fighter in the fifth round than in the first. So
I think a really important thing here is that we all know, no matter how many times fighters say it, cage rust, ring rust exists. He's been on the sidelines for 18 months now.
Jeez, has it been that long?
It was April when UFC 129 was. You know what I mean? But My whole thing with it is he's going to feel cage rust. He's going to get tired if it goes that fifth round. And we all know, and as you said before, Carlos Condit doesn't give up. So in that fifth round, if GSP is feeling tired and, you know, that double leg isn't as explosive as it was, it could be, because he hasn't fought in 18 months, the muscles just aren't working as much as they used to, he's going to get caught. And how he reacts to that, if he reacts to it the same way GSP kind of usually does react, we could see Carlos Condit be crowned as the best welterweight in MMA. Dum, dum, dum.
And I would say if he comes in and does that, you also got to put him up there in the top pound for pound. I mean, taking out GSP. Even a GSP that's had 18 months off. I mean, it's not like he's not putting 150% into training and going into this fight, which I think that plays into a lot as far as what type of cage rust you've got coming into a fight, is how hard you're going in training to knock that out. I mean, if GSP's training a little harder than he normally is, maybe taking a little more chances, then the cage rust might not be so bad. So, I mean, the cage rust, I don't know, man. I used to buy into it. I don't know if I do that as much as I used to.
Yeah, I do. I definitely do.
When still you, think when it's got that, something to do with it?
Yeah, I do.
But regardless, we're in for a fantastic card. And I think GSP Condit is going to be an exciting fight, even if GSP... The only way I could see this fight not being exciting is they both fight a safe fight, and I just don't see that happen. I think they're both going to go at it. That's the other thing, is neither of them believe that they're the champion. If you listen to them talk, neither of them are champions. So
I'm not a champion. No, you're the champion. I'm not a champion. Exactly. No, you're the champion.
That's the I've never seen two
people not want to be champion.
I am not the champion. He's not the champion. Nobody's the champion, and so. But yes, this is going to be a fantastic card. I've been really, really looking forward to seeing this card. So everybody should be in for a really, really fun night.
Cool. No, I completely agree. On to the other half of Across the Pond MMA, one of my favorite parts. I know it's Matt's favorite part. It's the entertainment section. Dun, dun, dun. Right, cool. Let's talk about your thoughts on Halo. Tell me what you think of it. I'm ready to get it. I can't wait to get it. I'm slightly excited in the worst possible kind of way.
Okay, you're big multiplayer, right? I mean,
I am.
That's what's your thing. So what did you think of Reach's multiplayer?
It was good. I still think Halo 3 had the best multiplayer, but
you enjoyed Reach's multiplayer.
I enjoyed it. Yeah, it was all right.
Okay, I did too, and I think that maybe I just didn't play it long enough, because from just talking to other people, towards the end it got really campy, camp happy, and people not moving out of their spawn points. Halo 4 really feels a lot like Call of Duty. It feels like Halo in Call of Duty, and I don't know if it's I can't really put a finger on it yet. I mean, because I've only played probably about 2 or 3 hours of the multiplayer, so. I mean, I'm still trying to figure out exactly what the difference is. The free for all fight or free for all matches for me are way, way, way more entertaining than the team based modes. So I'm reserving my decision on what I think of multiplayer as of right now. What I really liked about the Halo series is that you could start playing Halo and have success right from the beginning, because there was no ranking system, so you didn't have to get special shields or special weapons or being able to make different combinations that the lower tier guys can't do. It drives me crazy that things get set up that way, and that's what they're doing with Halo. They're trying to bring it in the Call of Duty ranking system with your ability to match up different abilities, and that to me just annoys the shit out of me. So that being said, though, I mean, it still plays fantastic. The servers are fantastic. It's super smooth, running. I think it's still clocking in like 30 frames per second. It's running on the same engine that Halo Reach ran on, I believe. Looks fantastic. What really blew me away, though, was the campaign. Holy crap. And I know you're not a campaign guy, but you have to...
I enjoy campaign.
I thought, okay, you do enjoy the campaign? Well, then you're going to just completely crap yourself. I mean, the CGIs... introduction at the beginning. I mean, I was trying to figure out, is that a person or is that computer generated graphics? I can't tell, because it is that crazy. And then the in-game graphics are fantastic.
So quick question, 42-inch HD TV, how good is it going to look in your opinion?
1080p?
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, like I said, you will be blown away. It looks better than anything that's been put on the 360. I mean, as far as graphics go. Now, the in-game graphics, when you're playing in the campaign, there's some spots here and there where you'll see some hiccups, and they get a little crazy with the lighting. But story-wise, I mean, if you're a fan of Halo, as far as if you've read any of the novels or anything like that, they really touch on some things that people have wanted to know about for a long time. And I can't wait to see what 343 does in the future. I mean, they took the ball and they just scored a 99-yard touchdown. I mean, they ran right with it. They didn't sit on their laurels and just say, hey, this is the Halo franchise. It's going to make money regardless. Let's just put something together and throw it out there. They really poured their heart into it, and I think it shows in the campaign. Multiplayer, like I said, I'm reserving. I'm not really sure how I feel about that yet. But it plays fantastic. I mean, if you're a fan of that type of ranking system stuff, I mean, the multiplayer plays fantastic. For me, it's kind of irritating.
Cool. I look forward to buying it. What thoughts on Homeland, last week's Homeland? Because obviously today is the next episode, as it were. What were your thoughts?
Did you get to see it then?
Of course I did. I watched it every month.
Well, I didn't know. Yeah, but sometimes you get busy and you miss stuff. I really want to know what you thought about it, because I've said my thoughts several times on Twitter and.
I don't know what your thoughts are. I try and stay away from your thoughts over Twitter.
Up until this point, I thought Homeland hit it out of the park every episode. I know some people had a problem with the ending in season one. For the most part, for me, I've enjoyed everything that Homeland's done. This episode, not so much. I had some issues with it. I really had an issue with how it ended.
Look, I have one issue with that. If they've killed that guy, I'm going to go fucking crazy. Because I really, really like him. That sounded
weird.
Well,
I really do like him.
I like Quinn.
Yeah, I mean, if he was dead, they wouldn't have shown us that he was, you know, hanging on.
Yeah, I was speaking to a dude, a friend of mine, who's a very big DJ in the UK. And I kind of think of Kim as, did you ever watch 24?
Oh yeah, you know, I watched the entire series.
He's like the white Curtis. Do you remember Curtis? Loved Curtis.
Man, I'd have to probably pull it up and look at his face. Man, there's so many characters in that series.
I can tell you who Curtis is and you automatically remember him just by, like, I'll just describe him to him. Black guy. Was Jack Bauer's partner?
Black guy was Jack Bauer, and which that was towards the end of the series.
Midway through,
man. Yeah, I think I know who you're talking about, man. It's been a long time since I watched that series, but yeah, I'm pretty sure I know who you're talking about. Quinn's character is fantastic, and the show absolutely needs him.
Yes.
And so, but the ending for me, man.
There's only so much. Crazy you can get from Carrie until you need someone like Quinn to be like, yo, bitch, shut the fuck up.
Right, you do. I agree, because Saul is, he kind of plays into whatever the hell Carrie wants to do, and her boss.
I believe in the girl.
Yeah, so.
Oh, yes. God.
And Quinn makes things and tries to bring things into perspective. But, man, you were okay with a. Full body geared terrorist team in broad daylight coming through the front of the store, and the CIA didn't notice.
Look, I've watched every single season of 24. I'm going to be okay with a lot of things.
I know, but Homeland to me, for the most part, hasn't really done anything. Yes, the premise is pretty crazy, but for the most part, but within the show, with what they've created, I've for the most part, I've believed just about everything. I mean, there's been a few times where I'm like, eh. But that one, man, I really had a hard time taking it, even though it was a CIA forensics team. They've been watching this store for, you know, however many months, and not, or was it weeks? Was it weeks?
Didn't they take the team out, though? I'm sure the team were called away for after Brody said.
Well, but even if they did take the team out, again, these guys had to approach in broad daylight in the front of a store in a town that's busy. They were worried about people coming in and into the tailor shop. So there's people all over the place.
Just suspend your belief.
I know, but it's so hard, man. I was just like, that's just so – I mean, you guys could have done – they could have done – I mean, it was just like literally like, okay, we've got to – they can't find the C4. We've got to figure – how are we going to keep them from finding C4? Well, let's just get a full body – you know, military team going there and just wipe everybody out. I mean, I don't know, man. The forensics team not being able to handle those guys coming through. I could get that because they're not field agents. But I just had a hard time dealing with it. So I'm hoping this next episode. I mean, this really was a lot of story building too in this episode. So it was a little bit slower right until the crazy end. So hopefully we get back on track.
I think it needs that after four episodes of just. Pure holy shit. It kind of needed an episode to just slow down, let everyone get their bearings back.
And then give you a holy shit moment right at the end.
Exactly. You know what I mean? They've done so many things in the first four episodes that could have been, you know, they could have been finales.
Oh, I know. That's what we discussed, I think, on Twitter briefly. Yes. I mean, that was just one, it felt like one finale after another.
It feels like that's sort of been the theme as of late with a lot of TV shows that have been on recently and on during this period of time, during the fall. Dexter, the first episode, should have been the finale. Really, that would have been a great finale, but it just made for a great first episode, which is, you know, giving us great moment after great moment after great moment. Homeland, when she confronted Brody, should have been the finale, really. But it's continued to give great moment after great moment, even probably an Emmy Award winning moment with the two having a conversation. And The Walking Dead, literally, is there a time, a moment when this show isn't given great moments, heartbreaking moments, moments where people are crying? It's just one of those things recently. And I think they needed to take a real small break from that. Otherwise, they were just going to give an audience a sort of, like, you know, how much more do I need to see of this, really? Is life really this exciting, being a CIA agent? You know.
I would say absolutely not. So, but yeah, I'm really looking forward to tonight's episode, though. So I can't wait to see what they do.
Cool. What did you think of Dexter last week?
And Dexter fell into the same thing, man. I almost feel like they might have even jumped the shark at the end of this last episode. It was a little bit.
I'm not going to use the word jump the shark. I think that's a bit of a harsh word to use. When I use it, I mean it. It's like the word love. Oh. But
well, that means a lot to me with all love you throw my way.
Oh, dude, it's guy love. There's nothing gay about it.
All right, chocolate bear.
Love between two guys. Yeah. but yeah, that was a bit. Like, I kind of saw it coming, but it doesn't make sense.
No, not at all.
At least whenever any other time that he's sort of been with a chick, it sort of made sense. Whereas this one, it's just like, really, dude? Why?
It's almost like they're like, we've got to have Dexter interacting with another female on a personal level, because it's been, I think, fairly successful in the series. And so they just kind of, it feels like they really forced this to happen.
He gets some fine-looking women, too, to be fair. Good old
Dexter. Yeah, he finds the craziest fine-looking women out there.
Oh, but I don't blame him either. But yeah, Matt, it doesn't seem like him. One moment he wants to kill her, another moment he's literally having full-on unprotected sex.
I mean, and it's not even one minute. I mean, the guy was wanting to kill her. I mean, that was one of my favorite lines, I think, the week before, and I can't remember exactly how it went, but it was, she was saying that, you know, do you want to take me out on a date? And he's like, yes, I want to take you out. And I was like, that's funny.
That was last week, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was last week. And so I have a hard time buying into that. I mean, especially with the protocol he's got set up as far as, you know, who to kill and who not to kill. I mean, he's made a few slip-ups throughout the years, but for the most part, he sticks to it. And he's never, even with other females that deserved Dexter's knife, he's never made a mistake like this. So I don't know, man. I have a hard time buying into it.
I think a worthy question is, what has she got that so many others haven't? And is she just another, like, a more blatant version of Lila? For me personally, that's the question I'm asking.
Well, they really have to drive this home in this next episode as to why he let her go. I mean, maybe we just need him to, you know, to explain it, which he does do often when he does something crazy. We get to hear him thinking it over. So tonight, to me, is going to be the make or break for me personally of this season after doing what they did in this last episode.
I think that's a bit harsh to give it a make or break.
I know. I think it's a bit harsh. But to me, Dexter's been kind of schizophrenic. I mean, inconsistent as of late. And so for me personally, with so much other great television out there, I think that this, for me, I think they really need, I mean, I could probably give them a second, another one more episode, but they need to do something, because I'm not a happy camper.
I wasn't a happy camper last year, but you know what? They've really, really impressed me this year. So
well, they had a fantastic storyline going into this, and so that's why I'm just kind of upset with what they've done. So we'll have to see. We'll have to see.
You're a hard taskmaster, sir.
I know. I'm pretty difficult.
Yes, you are. Films. World War Z. Do you want to give your opinion first, or shall I give my opinion first? I've only got two words to say.
Go ahead.
Holy shit. Holy shit.
Is that a good holy shit or a bad holy shit?
It's a goddamn, that looks beautiful. I might have to eat a very strong cookie before I watch it.
I tell you what, have you read the book?
I haven't read the book.
Okay. People that have read the book are just crushing this trailer, with good reason. But I'm a pretty hard taskmaster when it comes to book to movie translations and whatnot. But with the way the World War Z reads, I don't really see how you could make a movie about it and do it justice. And so if you're going to make it a movie, you might as well just get completely away from the book and just do it with the idea of a global zombie apocalypse and show it on the grand scale that they look like they're going to be doing. The only thing that I have a problem with is I'm old school special effects, so I hope they have some of that because it looks like there's a ton of CGI stuff going on. But it does look crazy. And they went in with the purpose of saying, you know what, the zombie genre is overran right now, and it has taken over the horror genres. I mean, there's so much zombie stuff out there, games, movies, books, comics, everything, that they really wanted to spin up some different scenes and stuff that we've never seen happen before in a zombie movie. And it looks like they have succeeded.
Yeah, you know what? I'm really looking forward to it, man.
I am too. I mean, it's $180 million budget is what they've got on this thing,
and it looks huge. Sounded wrong again. What the hell, man?
You didn't say he, so we can let that one slide.
Thank you. Right? Yeah. No, film looks like it's on a completely magnificent grand scale, and I think that's the thing that excites me about it the most, to be honest. Yeah, that's really it. And, you know, I trust Brad Pitt. I really do trust Brad Pitt. I think he's probably one of the best actors of his generation.
And that's really what has tied this movie up, because it was supposed to release this year. But Pitt, his opinion on the third act caused them to go back in, even after filming part of the third act, and completely rewrite it and reshoot it. So Mark Forster and Pitt have been at odds throughout this film, and evidently Brad Pitt won out, and apparently everybody's really happy with the ending. So the ending's a way better ending than what they had set initially.
That's good. Well, it shows, you know, I mean, that it shows that he genuinely cares, and sometimes you don't really get that with film guys. They're sort of like, whatever, I don't care, just give me the money. And it's good that, you know, Pitt is really giving a damn about this film that clearly means to a lot of people. And to be honest, there's going to be a lot of people who are like, boo, this isn't what I expected it to be.
Oh, absolutely. The fans of the novel are going to crush this movie. And the fans, there's also evidently a groundswell of people that hate fast zombies. So
why would you hate fast zombies?
I don't know. I mean, you know what the genre is?
Because it doesn't make sense.
Listen, well, right?
It there doesn't. In reality,
scary about a dude walking towards you who wants to eat your face.
But in a reality where zombies actually exist, if we're going with the lore of zombies, right? You know, it's the, you know, their most basic primitive, you know, brain functions still exist. Running is not one of those. Like, when you're a decaying corpse, how do you have the muscle strength to even run fast? Like, ambling slowly makes sense. Running at a sprint does not make sense. Like, it just
yeah, but the horror genre never makes sense. That's such a cop out. I mean, it doesn't make sense. And we don't right
cop
now
out?
That we don't know what kind of zombies they are and how they were infected.
Cop out.
I mean, 28 days zombies.
They were
that
not
was a
zombies.
But they are looked at by the community as being zombies.
I'm part of the community. I do not look at them as being zombies.
Okay. But they are, that is...
The community!
Clearly we have one of the World War Z's non-fans.
Right. Guys, on to the next one, because I do have a chicken in the oven, no pun intended, or anything like that. I'm not, it doesn't mean I've got someone pregnant, hopefully not. But, yeah, next thing, Evil Dead, thoughts? I've never actually seen the Evil Dead.
You've never seen the original or the trailer for the new one?
Both.
Oh my God. Well, you know what? Just forget about watching the original and watch this trailer.
Forget about watching the original.
Okay. Do what?
Forget about watching the original that everyone
Forget
loves.
About watching the original because the trailer, I mean, Raimi has handpicked the director for the new Evil Dead, the reboot. And again, I'm not a guy that's big on reboots. I typically frown upon it, especially when it's from it's being a movie that I have a lot of love for. And I mean, it's nostalgic for me. I mean, Evil Dead, I loved watching it as a kid, which is kind of weird, but I did. But Alvarez is just amped. I mean, the holy shit factor in Evil Dead 2013 is amped up 10 times a thousand.
So it's a remake, right?
It's a remake, and it's still got the basic same premise as the first two films, which Evil Dead 2 is actually a remake of Evil Dead.
Okay, cool.
Which makes, you have to, because Raimi didn't have enough money when he filmed Evil Dead to do everything he wanted to do. And so when they did Evil Dead 2, it was basically his opportunity to do what he wanted to do in Evil Dead. So the real sequel was Army of Darkness, if that makes any sense.
So who's playing Ash?
Nobody's playing Ash. Ash is not in the movie.
It's
a girl is playing. It looks like they're giving the girl the lead. From what I've said, I've not read a lot about the film. All I've seen was the trailer. All I've watched is the trailer. But it looks like there's a female character. I think the actress's name's Jane Levy is playing the lead. Just watch the trailer. The end of the trailer. If it doesn't make you shudder, nothing will. I mean, to me, like some of the worst, like Pet Sematary, when the little kid cuts the Achilles tendon. I hate seeing Achilles tendons cut in movies, and they kind of give me the creepies. But the end scene that they show in Evil Dead is, oh my God. It will stick with you for a very long time.
Okay, cool. I'll watch that as soon as I get off this bloody show with you guys. So... Right, let's. Is there anything else to talk about? Buy the Deftones album. It's magnificent. Is there anything else to talk about?
No, I think we hit it all, man.
Tremendous, tremendous. Matt, is there anyone you'd like to thank?
As always, we got to thank Fight Fans Radio, everybody that listens to the show, our producer, Erica Lewis, and you got to thank Andre for doing such a fantastic job today, even with his chicken in the oven and all of his sexual innuendos.
For real. As Matt said, shout out to Fight Fans Radio. They're doing a fantastic job, and I hope they like us on being on their channel, because we kind of like being on their channel, but we'd also like for them to send us meals every so often, because we hunger. Aside from that, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to Across the Pond MMA. My name is Andrew Jacobs. That was Matt Simpson a minute ago. Erica, please play that funky music, which really isn't that funky. Please. Pretty please?